Ej, kurio, ale
There's so many false positives. Like in this example. So the first, the two programs are going to point, and then we should crash the program immediately. It was actually executed. Yeah, I told you about using one time. It doesn't affect. Because you're in the cache. So the cache exception was too late, maybe. So it did something, although it should have crashed already. So that's interesting. That means that out of all the executed instructions, these microarchitectural traces, and that can be some state of the cache. It can be other microarchitectural elements that are brought to a different state, but it can also be some concurrency effect. We give a name to such instructions. We call them transient instructions because we somehow execute them, but then they vanish before they are actually architecturally made visible. So we can, through microarchitectural side channels, then observe the execution of these transient instructions. We found on December 3rd, we were quite busy around the time because we were still busy with the research on the other, like I told you earlier, by that time. But on December 3rd, we decided, okay, we should probably prioritize this and look at this now. And then we looked at this independently, and all three of us came up with an implementation of the Meltdown attack, and we discovered that it actually worked. So the only thing that we need to change from my code example earlier is, if you remember, the first example that we had, we just used the address from the kernel and dereferences it. But this time, instead of using printf, we just access the array at the index represented by the bytes that we just read. And then we do the same flush and reload attack again as earlier, mount it over the entire array, and check if there's a part of the array that is now cached. So we say just adding another layer of indirection again solves all the problems, like all the time. I do. Okay, so let's try that. Wow. So I did that, and I got a cache hit. Yeah. Exactly at this index of the value at the address I dereferenced. So the index of the cache hit actually revealed the value that's stored there in the kernel memory. So the version check wasn't fast enough. This sounds like leaks, and this is Meltdown. Meltdown is using out-of-order execution to read data from any address. The index of the cache hit reveals what data we read because we encode it through this cache sidechain to transmit it from the out-of-order execution realm to the normal world. The permission check is not fast enough in some cases, and the entire physical memory is typically accessible through the kernel space. And we reported this to Intel on December 4 and then continued working in this direction. And one of the first things that I wrote on December 3rd, that was the, I wrote a tool to dump just arbitrary memory locations, dump and dump of memory, and kernel memory all over the terminal. So we also wrote the demo of this. We just start with a certain address and dump the memory. And in this example, the address is located at the position in memory where there is a lob store for the descriptions of the package manager installed on the system, and we just dump it. If there were a key stored there, we could also take the key. So independently of what's written there, we can code that we showed before. We can only read a single character and then the flash reload, but it crashes immediately because it's still an exception that has to be handled. So how do we prevent the crash and dump the memory? So like in the beginning I said, when there is an exception, we just catch the exception. So we can just do forward handling, we catch the exception, jump back, and try again. In addition, we can also do perform suppression by using Intel TFX, which we'll see pretty soon. Yeah. When we got in touch with Paul Kotcher, through Intel interconnected network with us, Paul Kotcher, he told us that he found something he called Spectre. And then we thought, okay, yeah, we can also use this to suppress faults, like a Spectre fault. Yeah, so this Spectre execution, we can also prevent the faults in the first place. So let's talk about the suppression of TFX, because I think this is one of the most popular versions of Meltdown. TFX is a really cool feature. It was designed by Intel to replace locking in certain scenarios, but we used it for a lot of different things already, because there's a really cool side effect of suppressing exceptions. You just start a transaction and do stuff whatever you want to do, and you can do illegal stuff in it, like dereference a kernel memory address, which will only throw an exception, but the TFX transaction just avoids there and doesn't crash the application. So we can simply start a TFX transaction before we do all this Meltdown magic. The transaction will work, but it's fine, the memory doesn't crash, and we get the memory and we can build a loop and dump the whole memory with that. Yeah, and then we can play, yeah, because we don't have to handle exceptions like in an exception handling case. Yes, also, that's the execution to prevent the exception to occur in the first place. So in this example, we have the speculate variable, which is just there on the model tool. And then the ending value in there, we choose an address, which is either the valid address or the inaccessible kernel address. Then we have the if condition. And depending on what the value is, we can try to determine the position of the format. But like it's creating the function vector, it doesn't know this place. Okay, we'll agree to that condition or not, because it hasn't been read. The variable is speculate yet. Or at some point, try to read the kernel address and then use the value to note the address source at the index of the array, and then we have the function field again, and then we can also reach the kernel. We can even improve the performance by a really nice glitch by adding an additional hyperparameter dereference to the outer outbound. They look really like our outbound, so we learned a lot of them during the development. So in our code, we just add an outbound dereference before we dereference the kernel address, so more illegal stuff in our application. And this is really cool because it makes the attack more stable. Because apparently the outbounder blocks some exception handling and a lot more time to actually make this value. So all very nice, but you can only leave data that is in level 1 cache, right? Not anything else. So I told you that you can leave the entire memory contents to find out. Okay, so what we saw in January, and this is that we had a lot of trouble convincing other people that we can actually leave data that is not in the level 1 cache. It was assumed that we can only leave data that is not in the level 1 cache. This was also the yarn from the Project Zero about it. And we tried a lot of things, and for example, we experimented by forcing the Meltdown attack to run the process of forward, and then on a different call, we had the secrets in the application, so we can't share the first level cache, the L1 cache, only the last level cache, and we're still able to leak the secret, so it can't be the case with the L1. It also works with the L3 cache. We also make sure that it's never an L1 by constantly flushing the secret, and still, we were able to leak it. It took a bit longer, so it was not that fast in leaking the values, but still, we were able to leak values that are also in a level 3 cache, and of course also in a level 2 cache. And during this, Meltdown would even get the values into the level 1 cache for us, in some cases. But we can also be got one step further by using uncacheable memory. So we mark pages in the page table as uncacheable, and this means that every read or write operation will go directly to the DRAM. So it will bypass the cache entirely. So we make sure it's not in the level 1, level 2, or level 3 cache, it won't be stored in the cache at all. And if the attacker is able to do the true load of this value by either issuing a syscall that then uses this value, on the same CPU core, the data still can be leaked. So we think that Meltdown might read the value directly from one of the buffers in this scenario, because they are shared between threads running on the same core. So one hyperthread can attack the other. So you can dump the entire memory, but it's do all what you need to try and never you have a lot of them. You just want to make secrets, you don't want to tell anything. Just find something that you're interested in leaking and do a targeted attack system, not the entire memory dump, but something like, say for example, you have this encryption, right? This is very good, don't trust to put this encryption as a software tool. So you at some point stores the key of your hard disk in software, and if you have the key, then I can get a laptop to your hard disk, and then all you need to do is encryptions. So you won't be tempted to search for the key, right? It's just a small encryption, and we can find out where it is. So we actually need to demo it. So on the right is the shell by yourself, and it has the correct identification of the recent version that you can download today.
Thank you.
Android authentication, for instance, which you would also be stored in a register when you could reach the key with that. Also, for the demo review on the Samsung Galaxy S6. And when we run our attack there, we can see that immediately we can dump all the registers of different privilege levels that our user space application usually has no access to. Okay, so who is affected by this variant? Peter is affected. We heard first rumors about that in January, so Peter publicly disclosed this in May 21st. The then disclosure, they said that almost every CPU is affected, and it includes root system registry. So we talked about Meltdown now. Is Meltdown a sidechannel attack? It was a sidechannel attack. I think it's not a sidechannel attack, and I'm very certain about that. Because for a sidechannel attack, you would have to use a sidechannel to read some secret value. And read the data directly, we directly exit it. It doesn't really work any more directly. It just dereference the pointer and read the value into a register. How can it be any more directly? Okay, we then use a sidechannel internally for transmission from one realm to the other. But just because we use a sidechannel somewhere in the process doesn't make the entire thing a sidechannel attack. If you have some malware running on an AirGap system and transmit the data to the outside through some fancy channel, it doesn't make the entire attack a sidechannel attack. A sidechannel attack means that it's much more passive. The victim is not actively manipulated in some way. Okay, but if it's a sidechannel attack, is it a speculative execution, at least? Yeah, okay, so we often heard that Meltdown is speculating beyond faulting instructions, and that's not speculative execution, that's just out of order execution. We're already running instructions out of order that follow after the current instruction. But even if you say, okay, I still want to call that speculative execution, fine. But speculating beyond faulting instructions is not even the actual problem. AMD does that, and they are not affected. It's not the problem that anyone is speculating beyond faulting instructions here. The problem is that we are fetching and using real values for instructions after we are having a faulting instruction. So the problem is fetching and using the real values here. Okay, we should fix that. I guess because there's a really, really bad problem here. So we should find out how to fix that. The problem here is in hardware. So the problem is rooted in hardware. So ultimately, we should fix that in hardware. So there's a condition between the memory fetch and the condition check, and we have to fix that in hardware. And it can also do a hard split of the user space and the kernel space. So it was already designed for ARM, but I guess already since I used it before, so that the kernel space is not even there if you run in user space. So fixing the hardware is a long-term solution. We cannot just replace all the CPUs right away. So we need a short-term solution. You have to find something in software. Yeah. And the problem are the kernel addresses. Kernel addresses are there in user space, and we can't just take those kernel addresses. We don't need them usually, and remove them. If you run in user space, we don't need kernel addresses. We cannot access the kernel. We don't need the kernel there. The problem here is that the user space accessibility check is not reliable in hardware. So our idea was we just unwrap the entire kernel in user space, and then the kernel addresses are no longer present. And if they are not present, then you can't translate them to any physical address, so you can't run the check. If you think back of our operating system illustration, we could just switch from this view to the separate kernel directions of you. And now the user can run the attack, so the user can run through the wall, but there's nothing behind it, so the user can't gain anything from it. Yeah. So actually, we published Kaiser in May 2007 to not to mitigate Meltdown, but to mitigate other side-chain attacks, because Meltdown wasn't known out of them. And inadvertently, and luckily to us, it also defeats Meltdown. We introduced the BSD implementation of the Linux kernel, which we also uploaded in May. And yeah, it was not that easy, so just unlocking the complete kernel address space is not possible. The architecture still requires some parts of the kernel to be present, like interrupt descriptor tables. If you have an interrupt in user space, for example, because you move mouse and the stuff in the keyboard, we still need something mapped in the kernel, so program stacks, different things, stuff for public switches, we still need a few parts of the kernel mapped in the user space. Also, in addition, when we want to switch to the other address space, we need to know the physical location of that. So we need to update the CFU register with this address, and this address has also to be stored somewhere. And how can we do this efficiently? So instead of one page for directory, we now use two. There are 8K lines and also 8K lines, and then we can do a nice trick. We can just flip the 12-bit of the pointer to switch between those halves and therefore move those metrics. So as you can see on the illustration at the bottom, we just flip one bit, then we use the another offset, which is our other address space, and then we can continue. And therefore we do not need to store the address somewhere else, which we need to translate and then store in the CFU register. We can just use the value already stored there, flip a bit, and then change the address space. This is pretty nice. So Inner and Other is improved over our Kaiser patch starting from May. We already got first feedback in May, and later on we got also emails from Intel asking us specific things about the Kaiser patch, and then finally notifying us that they developed a larger patch set, which actually makes this practical for the Linux kernel. I was later on merged into the Linux kernel as KPTI, because they didn't like the name Kaiser for some reason. Fun fact, Kaiser in German is the name of the largest penguin, the emperor penguin, but I think they were not aware of that. So there were also patches for ARM64, and it's not only in Linux, it's of course other major operating systems as well. For example, Apple released updates already in December, I think, and they had an option that was similar before, 32 bits, yeah, where it's doing rather the opposite. Yeah, they didn't unmap the kernel user space, but user space. Designs that are better in terms of security and grow up like other fields did, like this was the same in the car industry. We didn't get faster cars all the time, but at some point They also made the cars safer than before. So last but not least, we published our proof of concept implementation of the Meltdown attack on GitHub. You can download it there, compile it, and try it on your machine yourself. Hopefully your machine is already patched, so you need to disable the remediation to test it. We also add new code there that we just showed here. Okay, please. So to conclude our talk, in the end, we underestimated microarchitecture attacks for a long, long time. And with Meltdown, we exploit performance optimizations that allow us to leak arbitrary memory, which